Okay, good morning. Welcome to St. Mark's Lutheran Church on this 11th Sunday after Pentecost. As always, I have a few announcements to make. I guess I'll start with one. Starting tomorrow, I'm going to take a week of vacation. Later on in the week, my wife will be leaving for my hometown to visit friends and family back there, but we're going to take the week off. Next Sunday, there will not be children's Sunday school. Both teachers are away, so no children's Sunday school next week. Next Sunday, my good friend Pastor David Kaplan will be here leading worship. So he's been here before. Many of you have seen him, and so you're good hands with him. And then Pastor Marlene Phillips from St. John's Church Hill is available for any emergencies. So hopefully everyone stays healthy both next week and for a while. But if there anything would come up, please feel free to give Pastor Marlene a call. We also have a couple other things coming up real soon. Is the August 18th. We're getting close to school starting again. So Sunday, August 18th will be the blessing of students, teachers, support staff, and backpacks. So if you're a student, feel free to bring your backpack. And if you're a teacher or support staff, well, I'll have a blessing if you could come forward that day. So that's always special, and that'll get us ready for the new school year. And then, of course, we have the Wolfsville Picnic coming up. So that's Saturday, August 24th. As Linda Keller said last week, if you know, I think, do you have an announcement for that?
Go ahead, and then I'll add.
Well, I just wanted to add, again, if you know anyone, especially who travels for that picnic, that comes to it, if you don't mind giving them a call, making sure they know about the date change and the location change. So we're doing our best to get the word out. But if you know anyone, a phone call would be real good. That way, that they definitely get that information. And you might have sign-up sheets?
Yes. Okay.
That sounds good.
There's
yep.
A lot to absorb in there. We're looking for volunteers for the picnic. And if you have any questions, just ask. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So that's coming up fast. We continue to work on our church directory. If there's anybody here who'd like to get their picture taken today, so I have at least one family, two families, see my wife after church. And you know where the camera's behind my desk. All right. and then she'll take your picture. And then if I have time, I'll come down too. But Anna's really the photographer in our family. My dad's a photographer. Things seem to have skipped a generation. My dad's a photographer. He's very good with his hands and fixing and building things. And I'm not good at those things. I don't know why. I guess some things skip a generation. But Anna's really, in our house, she's the photographer. So she'll take, we have two pictures. And if there's anybody else here wants their picture taken, let us know. We'll take care of that today. So I think those are some of the big announcements, or at least upcoming dates and things we're working on. We do have some guests that I'd like to introduce. In the last row here, last pew, we have Judy and Steve Ivins. Judy's brother is Denny Grove, so that's how they're connected to us, and we're so glad that they could come and be with us today. They live in Chambersburg, so they had a little bit of a drive, but we really appreciate them being here and worshiping with us today. And I also, speaking of guests, this Sunday we are celebrating Holy Communion. So in the Evangelical Lutheran Church, all baptized believing Christians may receive communion. So just come forward. If for any reason you do not want to receive communion today but would like a blessing, either let me know, or if you cross your arms, then I'll know just to give a blessing. But all baptized believing Christians are welcome to receive communion. There is the option of wine or grape juice. The wine trays are going to be, there's going to be more cups. So if you want the grape juice, just let the communion assistant know, and that'll be the white grape juice, so that you'll know the difference there. But at least if you could, just point to that tray or tell the communion assistant. So that's going on today. Are there any other announcements for the good of the congregation? Mary?
Yes, I am passing a card for Vera Morris. Oh.
Well, actually, it'll be Friday. Friday's her birthday, right? August 9th?
Whatever the 9th is.
Yeah, okay, yep. That's right. So August 9th, I forgot to announce. I even asked Cindy, should I announce about your mom? And then here I am, and I forgot. So thank you, Mary. This Friday, August 9th, one of our members, Vera Morgan, turns 100. So we'll have, by this time next week, we'll have... two members who are in triple digits, so that's something to celebrate. Thank you for signing the card. Yes, Joyce.
So we have an update on Mark Kessler. I spoke with Angie this morning. She said he is doing somewhat better. He has good days, but he's still having some not so good days. The constant itching that was driving him crazy, that seems to have gone. But his feet are still sore and on the bottom, and they're swollen. They're not quite sure why that. And his blood values are still high, but they're trending down. And she said she appreciates all prayers.
Okay. Well, thank you for the update. So that was an update on Mark Kessler. Is my mic on? Okay. It just sounded like I don't sound on. Am I on? Okay. Everyone can hear me? Okay. For some reason, it sounded quieter to me. But Mark Kessler, please continue prayers for him. So he's doing slightly better, but it's definitely a need of prayers and God's healing. So prayers for Mark Kessler. Are there any other announcements for the good of the congregation? Yes.
Diagnosed with a serious illness, and I happened to pick up a get well card in it.
And we will certainly be doing that. So we'll, like I, yeah, Gail will continue to be in our prayers, and we hope you get the best possible news with the biopsy coming up. And we just pray for God's healing. And like you say, it's a road with some bumps, but we're definitely, like you said earlier, this is definitely your family here, your church family, and you will definitely be in our thoughts and prayers, and we'll be keeping up with your progress for sure. So we also pray for safe travels then too down to Duke. So yeah, thank you for the update, and like I said, we just pray for God's healing. Are there any other announcements for the good of the congregation? Well, then at this time, let us prepare our hearts for worship with the prelude. At this time, I would like to invite the congregation to please rise in body or spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And
let us pray. O God, eternal goodness, immeasurable love, you place your gifts before us. We eat and are satisfied. Fill us and this world and all its need with the life that comes only from you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Please be seated.
The first reading is from Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 through 4 and 9 through 15. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way, I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard you complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsively Psalm 78. So God commanded the clouds above and opened the doors of heaven.
Rain down them grain from heaven.
So mortals ate the bread of angels. God provided for them food enough.
The Lord caused the east wind to blow with the heavens, powerfully like the south wind.
Raining down flesh upon them like dust, and flying birds like the sand of the seas. So the people ate and were filled, for God gave them what they craved. The next reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. I, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, Father of all, who is above all and through all in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by wind of every doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Thank you to God.
I invite the congregation to please rise for the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered, Very truly, I tell you, you are only looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. Then they said to him, What must we do to perform the works of God? Jesus answered them, This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. So they said to him, What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What works are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, He gave them bread from heaven to eat. And Jesus said to them, Very truly, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, Sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. And let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In our first lesson today, we find a group of hungry people who are looking for food to eat. In our gospel lesson, we find a group of people who were recently fed, but they would like to see more free meals in their future. So they were fed, but they want more. In both cases, the people are focused on their immediate needs, on their earthly needs. And in both situations, we see that God cares about the immediate needs of human beings. However, in both time periods, we find God trying to expand the human mind so that we would not only be concerned with the present and our immediate needs, but so we would know who we can trust and who we should look to for all of our needs. Well, it might seem difficult for us to imagine how the Israelites could have witnessed plagues and the parting of the Red Sea and yet remain so negative and so selfish. In our lesson for today, we are told that the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And they said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." And then in our gospel reading, Jesus tells the crowd that has been following him, "Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves." St. John does not use the word miracle in his gospel account. Instead, he uses sign. And the reason he uses the word sign is to illustrate that through Jesus' miracles, we are able to see, and therefore we should believe, that he is the Son of God, that he is the Christ. But sadly, that fact does not click with this group of people. And like the Israelites in the wilderness, they are focused on their immediate needs and concerns. When I read our lessons for this week, I started to think about a scene from one of my favorite movies. In the movie Star Wars: Return of the Jedi, the group of heroes are out in the wilderness. And the one character who looks like Bigfoot, looks like Sasquatch, his name is Chewbacca in the movie, or Chewie they'll call him. He sees a piece of meat on a stick. Well, before the other heroes can stop him, Chewbacca grabs the meat and all the heroes are caught up in a net. Harrison Ford's character in the movie, Han Solo, then says, "Great, Chewie, great. Always thinking with your stomach." Now, in science fiction, the alien characters often have some human traits in them. And the character of Chewbacca, who sometimes thinks with his stomach, is not unusual from human beings. My wife can attest to the fact that the question I ask her more than any other question is, "What are we going to do for dinner?" She hears that more than any other question. It's a question that's always on my mind. And I hope it's a question that my wife never gets tired of hearing. Well, again, as human beings, we can think with our stomachs. Now, not everyone is concerned about food, as you know, some people are, but not everyone is that's not their main concern. But it's common for human beings to focus on what they think will make them happy right away. For example, I know a few people in my life who think an awful lot about money. Thoughts like how to get more of it or being jealous of people who have more than they do are common thoughts and topics of conversations with them. So again, the human race is often focused on the present, on what we think will make us happy right now. Now, always remember that God truly cares about our present needs. In our first lesson, the Father provided manna and quail for the Israelites in the wilderness. And in our gospel And you know, John chapter 6, Jesus did feed those 5,000 people, and everyone got enough to eat. So it is important that we bring our daily needs to God and ask for his help. At the same time, God is asking us to place our trust in him and to even trust him when our present reality does not appear to be very good. In our first lesson, the Lord said to Moses, I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way, I will test them, whether they will follow my instructions or not. Now, if we keep reading this chapter, we will find that God did not let the Israelites store any of this food. We are told, and Moses said to them, let no one leave any of it over until morning. But they did not listen to Moses. Some left part of it until morning, and it bred worms and became foul. And Moses was angry with them. Morning by morning, they gathered it as much as each needed. But when the sun grew hot, it melted. So here we see God provided for his people, while at the same time, God is trying to help them to grow in their relationship with him. God wants all of us to trust him to provide for us both in the present, but also in our future. And placing our trust is one of the first steps in entering into a relationship with God. And that's what God wanted from the Israelites. He wanted that relationship. He wanted them to know, you can trust me. In our gospel lesson, Jesus is once again teaching people that in order to have an everlasting relationship with God, that they need to follow him and they need to believe in him. Jesus tells the crowd, do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. The crowd responds by saying, what must we do to perform the works of God? And Jesus answers them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. Well, sadly, this group of people is not able to grasp what Jesus is teaching them. They then ask for more signs and then in the coming weeks, we will see them struggle even more with the words of Jesus. Well, like our first lesson, Jesus is trying to get people to think beyond their present concerns. Jesus is asking people to make a lifestyle change, to make a change that will not only cause them to place their trust in God to care for their needs, but to trust God that they should follow his commandments and proclaim his good news, even if it's not popular to do so. And that is the life that the 12 disciples lived once Jesus ascended into heaven and the Holy Spirit came upon them. They went wherever God led them. They proclaimed that good news, whether it was popular or not. And that's part of the lifestyle that Jesus is calling all of us to. Now, as many of you know, I am not much of a sports fan, so I've not been watching the Olympics. But I do follow the news, and the news has been a little confusing, at least for me. Some of the news reports I have read and have heard claim that the Last Supper and Christianity were being mocked at the opening ceremony of the Olympics, that Christianity was basically under attack. Of course, other reports I read and heard said that the opening ceremony had nothing to do with the Christianity and the Last Supper. So I've been hearing conflicting things. Now, I did watch a clip of this controversial moment, and I will say that it was not my cup of tea. But one possible good outcome about this controversy is that it reminds us of our calling to believe in and follow the Son of God, are calling to proclaim the gospel, even if it's not popular. Now, I do want to say first that as Christians, there's nothing wrong with having a little fun with our faith. For example, there are lots of good, clean, and well-meaning jokes about the Bible and Christianity. I read one recently where a Sunday school teacher was teaching the Ten Commandments to her 5- and 6-year-olds. After explaining the commandment to honor thy father and thy mother, she asked, is there a commandment that teaches us how to treat our brothers and sisters? One little boy shouted, thou shalt not kill. I thought that was really good. So as Christians, it's good to have fun. And jokes like that can sometimes help us to meditate more on our faith. You know, it kind of reminds us of our human relationships, for example, and how God wants us to treat each other. So those kind of well-meaning fun is a good thing. Now, on the other hand, if we do find someone who is mocking or putting down Christianity and leading people away from Jesus, well, that is an opportunity to witness to our faith, to proclaim that Jesus is the bread of life, that whoever comes to him will never be hungry, and whoever believes in him will never be thirsty. It's an opportunity to witness to the fact that Jesus not only cares about our day-to-day needs, that Jesus not only leads us to eternal life, but that Jesus is calling us to lives of good works. He's calling us to a life of a saint. In our second lesson, St. Paul writes, the gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. All of us are asked to believe in the Son of God, who was sent by the Father. And in doing so, we are then called to go wherever he may lead us. And like with the ministry of Jesus, we may be called to minister in places where people are confused. And we may be called to minister in places where people are outright hostile. But no matter where we are called to proclaim the gospel, we need to remember that we can trust God to both lead us in this moment and that our ultimate destination is eternal life in the kingdom of God. So the current struggles we have now will not last forever. That Jesus is ultimately leading us to God's perfect kingdom. But he is calling us to constantly be building up the body of Christ. So again, as human beings, we truly are sinners. And that is why it's only natural for us to think with our stomachs. We may get angry with God when our lives do not turn out exactly the way we want them to. And kind of setting aside the controversy surrounding the Olympics, I will say it's common that when people mock God and lash out at God, not always, but many times it's because they're disappointed with God. But nowhere in the Bible does God promise to grant all of our wishes here on earth. Instead, we find Jesus, the Son of God, telling us to believe in him, to place our trust in him, and to follow in his example, to follow in his life of being a servant, even when life is difficult. And by doing so, we are promised that we will never be hungry or thirsty, and that we will be joined with the bread of life for all of eternity. Following Jesus brings us peace in the here and now, because we will know that our troubles here on this earth will not last forever. Following Jesus brings us peace right now because we also know that we are serving a perfect God. And God is only calling us to acts of charity here on earth. And following Jesus brings us peace in the present because we know that one day we will eat our fill in the eternal and perfect kingdom of God. Amen. invite the congregation to please rise in body or spirit. And with the whole church, we confess our faith using the words from the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Calling on the Spirit of wisdom to guide our hearts and our minds, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Father, thank you for giving us the bread we need for our body and soul. Thank you for providing for us even when we are estranged from you and from our neighbor. Thank you for Jesus, our life, our bread, our source of unity with you and with each other. Merciful God. Your church is the body of Christ. Give it unity with him and unity in him. Let your Holy Spirit fashion the church into the likeness of Jesus, so that when it speaks and acts, people hear and see their Savior. Merciful God. Make us mindful of our union with those who are persecuted for Jesus' sake. Let them know they are not forgotten by you or by the rest of the church. May their faith witness feed their enemies. May their faithful witness feed their enemies with the bread of repentance and faith. Merciful God, feed the people of this congregation with the living bread of heaven. Nourish us with the cup of blessing from Christ's hand. Help us to know the depth, height, and breadth of your love. Fill us with your Spirit so we can share your love with others. Merciful God, thank you for those who maintain food pantries, soup kitchens, community gardens. Thank you for everyone who feed the hungry and help them feed themselves. Grant that as bodies are nourished, minds, hearts, and spirits are also fed with the living bread from heaven. Merciful God. Guide the thoughts, words, and actions of our earthly rulers. Guide and teach them so all people receive what they need to live in peace. Give us the desire and means to feed one another, not only with bread that perishes, but also with your imperishable and holy word. Merciful God. You open your hand and fulfill the desire of every living creature. Please open your hand to grant health, hope, strength, and guidance upon all whose need is great. And we especially lift up those who are known to us. We lift up Irene, Mike, Mark, Stephanie, Ruthie, Philip, Avery, Leah, Connie, Harold, Gail, and all those we now name aloud are in our hearts. Feed them with faith and fill them with the refreshing waters of your grace and salvation. Merciful God, with reverence and affection, we remember before you all of our loved ones who have died and are at rest in you. Keep us in union with them through our union with Jesus. Strengthen bonds of affection with our fellow pilgrims along life's journey. Bring us all with all whom you have redeemed into the joy and life you share in union with your Son and the Holy Spirit. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We lift up these prayers to you, gracious God. Receive them into your holy keeping.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful Father, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, so that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated. Body of Christ given for you. The 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 body of Christ given for you. body of Christ given for you. The 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 body of Christ given for you. I think you like grape juice, right? Yeah. The body of Christ given for you. Did you get bread? Oh, okay. The body of Christ given for you. 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 We're going to switch.
Oh, yeah.
So if you want to come closer to me, you want to come here, you can. Benjamin, may God bless you, and may you continue to grow in God's love and grace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. Piper, may God bless you, and may you continue to grow in God's love and grace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The body of Christ given for you. 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 I'll consecrate those.
You love Christ.
Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all the people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." sorry. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. Supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Samuel. Switch. Sorry. The body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. What's your name?
Jason.
Jason, may God bless you and may you continue to grow in God's love and grace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. They don't receive right here. The body of Christ given for you. And what's your name? Gabriel. Gabriel, may God bless you and may you continue to grow in God's love and grace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. 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 Body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. I know Mrs. Kuhn. Is there anybody else? Or we just need the grape juice. You two want to trade?
Yeah.
Unless you want to say blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you. Given for you. Samuel, the body of Christ given for you. You got it. Which one do you like? The blood of Christ shed for you. Which one do you want? You want grape juice? The blood of Christ shed for you. And I'll take wine so we can put that here. I invite the congregation to please rise in body or spirit. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And let us pray. Gracious God, in you we live and move and have our being. With your word in this meal of grace, you have nourished our life together. Strengthen us to show your love and serve the world in Jesus' name. Amen. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon you now and forever. Amen.